always two people in every picture, the photographer and the viewer, and subtitles. This is the story of the Turkish Cypriot photographer, Mustafa Diana.
I see, when I was going to school, I saw everywhere photography, you know. And that time, I told myself, I will be photographer.
Mustafa Diana was born in August 1922 in Lefkoşa. His mother was a housewife and his father was a policeman. He started his adventure with photography after finishing high school in 1940.
Okay, now, when my father was at the age of 14, because of the Second World War, there was no job in the villages of Cyprus. Everybody was poor. So his father, that's my grandfather, first sent him to a carpentry place to do some woodwork. And he was very good at it. Then my grandfather's friend, who is the first photographer of Cyprus, his name was Fevzi Akarsu, took my father from the village to him to learn photography. And eventually, through that starting point, my father became the best photographer of Cyprus.
This was the first step in his photography career.
I finished the school, you know, that time. I went to learn photography, I like it. So my boss also, Mr. Dunesti, he teach me.
The teacher of Mr. Diana was Mustafa Fevzi Arkasu, a Turkish photographer who left unforgettable traces in society. He was born in Paphos in 1908. He was taken in by a merchant and brought to Nicosia after finishing elementary school. He studied and was trained as a photographer. He became the most masterful photographer at that time. He took up black and white pictures and had a successful career until 1956. He taught his skills to Mr. Mustafa Diana. Mr. Fevzi passed away in Lefkoşa in 1983.
Now, when he started with this friend of my grandfather who taught him the photography, he decided to open up his own photographic studio. While he was doing this, okay, he met a guy who was originally Jewish, living in Germany, and his sons was killed by the Nazis, two sons. So this guy, his name was Flashman, Jewish German, he was a guy who was an expert in photography. And he had very good associates in Israel. So he decided to send my father, because my father was like his son, to Jerusalem. Okay, so my father went there through this flashman and met a lady called Diana, who had cinemas, photographic shops, and everything in Israel. Apparently, there was only one coincidence that my father resembled this lady's son, and this lady treated my father like his son. So he persuaded my father to stay in Israel, but because of the Palestinian and the Israel war, my father had to leave Israel and come back to Cyprus. So the lady's name, because it was Diana, eventually it became Diana, which is my name. Okay, so it became my father's shop's name was Photo Diana. So that's how the name evolved.
Diana later became the name he passed on to his children and his wife, as well as the shop, Photo Diana.
I opened my shop when I was 21 years old. Too many, my customers, too many. I don't know, English, Turkish, Greek, too many people there coming, I got to take a picture.
Now, he opened his shop in the Greek side, next to a place called Cinema Palace. Okay, now it's a theater. And he was so famous that everybody wanted to take their wedding pictures at him, at his photographic studio, because it was the best. So then the problem started between the Greeks and the Turks. Of course, the Greeks had this EOKA organization against the Turks. So they didn't like the Turks. So the EOKA members burned his shop. So he had to move. He opened his own color printing laboratory because he learned that in Israel. So he was the first one to introduce and print all the color pictures in the laboratory in Cyprus. Then Turkey at that time didn't have color printing laboratory. So we had to do color printing for Turkey as well through the posting system.
Mr. Diana bringing color printing to Cyprus and having other achievements made him stand out from the rest. His life and his works were also used in the book Photography and Photography in Cyprus. The book is a compilation that highlighted the history and phases of photography, starting from the first photo. It was created by the photographer, Mr. Gazi Yüksel.
Ben 1963 yılında Lefkoşa'da, Kıbrıs Lefkoşa'da doğdum. İlk orta ve lise eğitimimi tamamladıktan sonra askeri görev için askere gittim. Askerden çıktıktan sonra liseyi ticaret lisesini bitirdiğim için sadece daktilo kullanmayı biliyordum. Daktilo makinesi kullanmayı biliyordum. O konuyla ilgili iş bulamadığım için Foto Ertan diye bilinen bir fotoğrafçının yanında çırak olarak çalışmaya başladım. Fotoğrafçılıkla ilgili olarak ilk fotoğrafçılıkla tanışmam böyle oldu. Orada 3-4 ay çalıştıktan sonra bir gazetede dizgici olarak, yani yazıları yazan bir görevli olarak iş buldum. Çünkü daktilo makinesini kullanmayı biliyordum. O zaman daha haberler daktilo makinesiyle yazılıyordu. O işi bulduktan sonra ona başladım. Fotoğrafla aramda bir boşluk oluştu. Ama orada spor fotoğrafları, daha doğrusu gazetenin spor sayfasını yapan ekiple tanıştım. Onlar bana neden sen de spor fotoğrafı çekmiyorsun diye teklifte bulundular. Ben de bir fotoğraf makinesi satın alarak futbol fotoğrafları çekerek spor fotoğrafıyla bu fotoğrafçılık olayına başlamış oldum. Fiili olarak o şekilde başlamış oldum. Spor fotoğraflarının ardından tabii ki gazetede haber fotoğraflarını da takip etmeye başladım. Böylelikle hiçbir eğitim almadan fiili olarak, yani icra halinde fotoğrafla ilgilenmeye başladım. Fotoğrafla ilgili bilgileri bilenlere sorarak öğrenmeye başladım o dönem. Sonra o bilgiler yetersiz kalınca kendimi dergilerden, kitaplardan o bilgilere sarılarak geliştirmeye başladım. Ve böylelikle hem fotoğraf sanatıyla ilgili bilgiler edinirken diğer taraftan da kendi mesleğimle ilgili olarak, pratik olarak da geliştirmeye başladım.
Like Mr. Diana, Mr. Yüksel got a chance to improve his photography through a connection. His teacher was known as Foto Ertan. The teacher of Mr. Gazi Yüksel was Mustafa Ertan. He was born in Larnaca in 1941. He graduated from high school with photography and also featured in the book.
Ki benim gençlik yıllarımda henüz daha gençlerin
mezun olduktan sonra ne yapacaklarına dair bir fikirleri olmadığı için ben de aynı süreci yaşadım. Ve böylelikle bir şans eseri fotoğrafla bir bağımız oluştu. Tabii bu oluşan bağ aslında ailemi sevindirdi. Çünkü onlar da fotoğrafı çok seviyorlardı. Ben bir taraftan dizgicilik işini yürütürken diğer taraftan da foto muhabirliği işini yürütmeye başladığım için buna sevindiler. İleriki yıllarda bu konuda kendimi oldukça fazla geliştirdim. Fotoğrafın geçmişiyle de ilgilenmeye başladım. Ve bu anlamda Kıbrıs'ta fotoğrafın geçmişinde neler olup olmadığını araştırmaya başladım. Bu araştırmalarım sonucunda 1995 yılında Kıbrıs'ta fotoğrafçılığın geçmişine dair bir takım birikimlere ulaştım ve bunları bir kitap halinde yayınladım. Geçmişten günümüze Kıbrıs'ta Fotoğraf Vitrinimiz adı altında bir kitap yayınladım. Bu araştırmalarım sırasında da stüdyo fotoğrafçılarıyla birebir röportajlar yaptığım sırada gazetede dizgicilik işini yaparken spor fotoğrafları ve ardından da haber fotoğrafları çekmeye başlamam ailemi sevindirdi. Çünkü onlar da fotoğrafı seviyorlardı ve benim de bu konuyla ilgilenmem onların hoşuna gitti. İlerleyen zamanlarda ben dizgicilik işinden daha çok fotoğrafçılık işiyle ilgilenmeye ve onunla hayatımı şekillendirmeye başladım. Fotoğrafçılıkla ilgili olarak ilk başlarda hiçbir eğitim almadım. Sadece bu işi pratik olarak yapanlara sorular sorarak elde ettiğim bilgilerle önümü görmeye başladım. Ama bu bilgiler yetmedi bana ve kitaplardan, dergilerden elde ettiğim bilgilerle kendimi geliştirmeye başladım. Fotoğrafçılıkla ilgili bilgilerimi geliştirirken bu arada Kıbrıs'ta fotoğrafçılığın geçmişine ilgi duydum ve bunu araştırmaya başladım. Öncelikle stüdyo fotoğrafçılarını tek tek gezerek onlarla röportajlar yaptım. Elde ettiğim bilgileri harmanlayarak 1995 yılında Geçmişten Günümüze Kıbrıs'ta Fotoğrafçılık diye bir kitap yayınladım. Bu kitabın hazırlanışı sırasında işte stüdyo fotoğrafçılarıyla röportaj yaparken Foto Diana ile de tanıştım. Foto Diana o zamanlar ve hala daha yaşayan en eski stüdyo fotoğrafçımızdır. Ve onunla tanıştıktan sonra onun yaşamın geçmişiyle ilgili de bilgiler elde ettim. Bu bilgileri de ilk yayınladığım kitapta kullandım. Foto Diana ile tanışıklığımız işte kitabın hazırlanışı yıllarına rastlar. O yıllarda sürekli olarak ben kendisini ziyaret ederek bu geçmişe dair bilgileri parça parça ondan öğrenmeye çalışıyordum. İşte bu ziyaretler sırasında da tabii ki o normal işini yapıyordu. Onu gözlemliyordum. Ama benim işim foto muhabirliği olduğu için onun yaptığı işle doğrudan ilgilenmiyordum. Çünkü o stüdyo fotoğrafçısıydı. Yalnız fiili olarak da o dönemler artık stüdyo fotoğrafı çekmiyor. Sadece fotoğraf baskısı yapıyordu. Renkli fotoğraf baskısı yapıyordu. O yüzden işte ışığı nasıl kullandığını, kompozisyonu nasıl yaptığını, portreyi nasıl ışıklandırdığını gibi bilgileri ondan öğrenme imkanım olmadı. Zaten dediğim gibi foto muhabiri olduğum için ilgi duymuyordum. Ama ilerleyen yıllarda tabii ki sohbetlerimizden elde ettiğim işte bilgi kırıntıları bana ilerleyen yıllarda bir şekilde faydalı olmuştur. Şimdi onları teker teker söyleme imkanım yok ama mutlaka bir şekilde etkilenmişimdir. Yaptığı işlerden, sergilediği fotoğraflardan etkilenmişimdir. Evet, Kıbrıs fotoğraf tarihini araştırırken röportaj yaptığım stüdyo fotoğrafçıları arasında Mustafa Diana da bulunuyordu. Onu ziyaretlerim sırasında o farklı bir iş yaptığı için, yani ben foto muhabiriydim, o stüdyo fotoğrafçısıydı. O yüzden farklı branşlarda iş yaptığımız için doğrudan bir teknik olarak bilgiler elde etmedim. Ama ilerleyen zamanlarda onu sık sık ziyaret ettiğim ve arkadaş olduğumuz için bu ziyaretler sırasında geçmiş dönemlerde, yani 1940'lı, 50'li yıllarda Kıbrıs'ta renkli fotoğraf olmadığı zamanlarda siyah beyaz fotoğrafların kendileri tarafından nasıl renklendirildiğini bana pratik olarak uygulayarak gösterdi ve bu konuda hangi noktalara dikkat edeceğimi, hangi fotoğrafın neresinde nasıl bir renk kullanırsam ya da bu rengi nasıl kullanırsam doğru sonuca ulaşabileceğimi gibi bir sürü o konuda pratik uygulamalar yaparak bana bilgiler verdi. Bu aslında ilerleyen yıllarda çok benim işime yaradı. Çünkü ben de pratik olarak kendi çektiğim siyah beyaz fotoğraflarda daha çağdaş bir şekilde bu fotoğraf boyamacılığını kullandım.
At the time, it was a different era of photography and a lot of manual work was needed. The specific techniques needed, he passed on to Mr. Ghazi.
There was negatives, you know, to make the negative, and on negative, he was using retouching, you know, it was film, you know, and now you don't need any retouching, everything is...
Of course, because we were the first laboratory, all the photographers, because they were working for my father, he taught them how to do retouching on the negatives, black and white photography, the studio lighting particularly, in the studio portraits, and the color photography, and double reproduction. You know what that was? What that was? You had the photograph facing that way, and you had the image of the same person facing the other way on the same photograph.
Double exposure or multiple exposure photography combines two images into a single one. It can be used to create a mirror image or a ghost image. The technique was mainly for artistic purposes and became popular with wedding photographs.
He was doing retouching, he was doing color, well, too much work on it. So I learned, you know, I make everybody, they like me, because I was doing the best pictures for them. The point is, have the will. You when they want to take pictures, they are coming. Wedding pictures, portrait pictures alone, you know. And I know this is from my, how I will explain you. When I saw your face, I want to take your pictures. Good sight is the best looking, you know, for you. So I was doing different, you know. I was taking pictures, they were very good.
Mr. Diana had a wide range of experiences. He took part in the photography fair and took pictures of political figures.
And here's the prize of international photography. In 1949, okay, he became the first best photographer of the competitors in the Cyprus Fair, internationally. He had taken a lot of famous pictures, famous ladies, singers' pictures, and a lot of army generals' pictures, British, Turkish, even Greeks, and he's the one who's taken the photograph of the first president of Cyprus, which is called Makarios. Okay, it was a bishop, archbishop, in the offices in the Greek side. Now they have his pictures. That's taken by my father.
If there is a spirit of goodwill, it is possible to find a solution.
He was born Michael Christodoulou Mouskos, and in 1948 he adopted the clerical name Makarios. In 1950, Makarios was elected the Archbishop of Cyprus. In 1959, he became the first president of Cyprus and stayed in office for 3 years. He was one of the main political figures that Mr. Diana took pictures of.
During that, you know, before, photography was very difficult. Now it's easy. Before, they were only 5 or 6 in one country. Say in Nicosia, there was about 5 shops. Limassol, there is about, you know, everywhere. In the cities, there was photographic shops. But now everybody, they are using cameras, and video cameras, everything. Now very easy. But before that time, during our time, not easy. We are doing always special photography, portraits, wedding pictures, you know. Everything, it was very difficult. There was studio cameras, not like this now. Special cameras for the studio. Now everybody, they have telephones, you know, on telephones. Cameras, everything, but during that time, special lights, special plates, you know. So everybody, they are coming to our shop. Nobody, there's no going everywhere to take picture, only in my shop.
Mr. Diana recalls how photography had changed during the years, the restrictions equipment caused, and the financial aspects of the job.
6 photograph, you know, they were at that time, half shilling, 1 shilling, you know, that time. Now, this money, everything is this money. Without money, you can. So I opened the shop to make money and to learn pictures, to make pictures. During that time, which one the best photographer, he was getting too much money.
Coming from 2 different generations of photography and 2 different backgrounds, Mr. Yüksel's approach was about using resources, whilst in the days of Mr. Diana, the available photographers were the resources.
I teach Photo Atlas, I teach Photoshop, I said, photo bambo in Greek side. I teach many, about 5-6 photographers I teach. I teach the photography, yes.
His 2 students, Photo Atlas and Photo Chic, were also documented in Mr. Yüksel's book. Faik Atlas was born in July 1932 in a village in Paphos. He graduated from middle school in Nicosia. He came across photography in middle school and he bought his first camera from his friend. He started taking pictures at school. He was inspired by an Armenian photographer. He later met Mr. Diana and worked with him for 3 years. Photo Atlas opened his own studio in 1955. Another one of Mr. Diana's students was Photo Chic. Mehmet Chic was born in December 1928. He graduated from elementary school and was involved in selling postcards. This was his first indirect contact with photography. He worked with Photo Diana in 1947 for 2 years. He then opened his own studio in 1953.
Tarihsel olarak geçmiş bilgilere sahip olmaları, sonra da bizim gibi durumlarda değildir onlar. Yani geçmişte eğitim olanağı en azından ülkemizde, adamızda yoktu. Biz o olanaktan, olanaksızlıklardan ötürü çok acı çektik. Çok yıprandık. Ama şimdi eğitim kurumlarımızda fotoğrafçılıkla ilgili olanaklar söz konusu. Bunlardan eğer konuyla ilgileniyorlarsa ziyadesiyle ilgilenmelerini tavsiye ederim. Çünkü kazanılacak bilgi önceden kazanılacak bilgi daha sonra hızla ilerlemeyi sağlayacaktır. Deneme yanılma yöntemiyle kendi kendine yapılacak çalışmalar kişiyi çok fazla ileriye götürmez. O yüzden kendilerini eğitmek için her türlü çabayı sarf etmelerini tavsiye ediyorum.
Besides teaching photography to others, his own son, Mehmet Diana, also learned a few lessons, as well as the business side of the profession.
Because my father injected this professional injection to me by learning, by doing it yourself and learning life, which meant he gave me a little photograph camera. Okay, at that time it was a camera which used 120 millimeter films. Not even that, even before that, there was a little microfilm that size. Okay, and there was a camera we put it in. That microfilm was two-sided, one this way, one that way, and the film rolled from one side to the other one within itself. So he told me, if you want money from me, you go and take pictures outside, and you come and learn how to print them, and you sell these photographs and make your own school fees. So I did this for 5 years. So I used to do that. Then, when he started, when the business got bigger and bigger, I went into the dark room and I learned how to print black and white pictures. So we started with the bleach, we started with the Pixar developer. So we used to put from the developer into acetate and then to Pixar and then print our black and white pictures, right? So it was different sizes, and my father was very delicate on these pictures, so sometimes I used to get up and reprint them again. Then, what happened was, after learning photography, we had to start doing color photography. Now with the printer, with the enlarger, it was very easy to print the, not the standard 9x12 photographies, but bigger sizes like 20 to 24 studio photographies, colors, right? But this wasn't enough. So we had to import from Kodak in Hemel Hempstead, in London. This was in Surrey, I believe. A Kodak color printer. And at that time, Kodak was a sister of a company called Durst. So we had half a Durst printer joined with a Kodak negative processor. So we had to first print with the Durst printer the photographs, roll them up and put them to a Kodak printer processor. So you used to put the roll in the film and it goes like that. So the color photographs was ready. Of course, in the meantime, you had to get a 36 millimeter negative processor as well. So you could put about 10 negatives into the processors and the machine used to do it for you. Okay? So this is how it developed. And we brought these machines from England to our laboratory. And this carried on practically for another 40 years between me and my father. Of course, I had to study in England my own profession at the same time to the university, which was not photography. It was a different thing. So this is the relationship between me and my father. Basically, what I did was, after all these laboratory formations, I got the agency for Canon, for North Cyprus, I got the Kodak for North Cyprus. Then Turkey started making these printers, so I got the agency for them. We set up a photographic laboratory for the army, Turkish army, for the police, Turkish police, and a couple of private companies. We imported them. Then I was the agent for Zenitsu cameras, which are very professional Russian cameras. And I was also the agent for Rolleiflex camera. He also imported at his time, which was very difficult, a brand, very famous brand called Voigtlander cameras, right? Of course, the Voigtlander are very famous for studio cameras. They're very professional cameras, very sensitive, with a Zeiss lens, I believe it was at that time, in the Voigtlander cameras. So we're talking about a very famous brand. This was his main distribution lines in photography. Apart from studio photography, he jumped into color photography, then he jumped into introducing cameras through me, photographic cameras through me, and chemicals, photographic chemicals through me. That was it. This carried on for 40 years. After that, he retired, and of course I had my own profession which I had to look after, and I was supporting him through as much as I can.
Not only did the shop make history, it also held sentimental value for those around it.
What I learned from my father, the photographic side of it, was that he was very sensitive to photographs. And he was extra sensitive. He had to do it precisely. I mean, even the pictures look perfect, he still said, no, this is no good, and you have to redo it. That was his profession. Okay, I'll tell you a joke about photography, okay? Which my father has experienced. Now, one day, a bald man came to him, and he asked him to take a studio photograph of him. But he wanted him to have, because he was bald, with hair, right? So they brought a, what they call the wig, the artificial hairs, right? They put him on his hair, but still there was a space left. So what we did was, what he did was, he put a shoe paint here on the man's head, and then he took a picture of it. Then he started retouching it on the negative, and nothing, the picture looked like it was real. Okay, I like one of the good points in that photography when I was working with my father was that when I was a little young student at the high school, I used to do all my homeworks in the photographic laboratory with his workers. And it was like a family place, and if it wasn't for that shop, I wouldn't finish my high school. Not even I would be able to get into the university, because there was poverty at that time because of the war, and we didn't have fancy houses or anything. We all lost our houses, so we had to move into my grandfather's house, and then I had to work for my school in my father's, for my lessons in my father's photographic shop. So it was very lovely because we were all close together. So this is the event I never forget.
Sensitivity, curiosity and passion are the key driving factors behind Mr. Diana's work. He retired at the age of 85 because of impaired hearing and sight. This was the last picture taken in his shop, and his love for the art is still alive inside.
Till now I am photographer.